Everyone, welcome to today's commissioner meeting of the Chester County Board of Commissioners. It is Wednesday, February 26, 2014. The time is 10:08, and surprise, surprise, it is snowing. My name is Ryan Costello. To my right, Terrence Farrell. To my left, Kathy Cazone. We are your Board of Commissioners, and this meeting is being videotaped for broadcast at www.chesco.org. If you are making a presentation during today's meeting, I ask you come to the podium on my right and state your name and position before making your presentation or comments. We will now call the meeting to order. And following the Pledge of Allegiance, which will be led by Gene Kasner, I would ask that we remain standing for a few moments, moment of silence for our first responders and servicemen and women. We will end with an update on Chester County Pipeline Notification Protocol. We will get through the business portion of the meeting first with a prediction that it will not take too long with everything having been sunshined yesterday. The board met in executive session on Tuesday, February 25th, 2014 to discuss personnel matters. And with that, I'm looking for a motion to approve the commissioner's meeting minutes from February 11, 2014.
So moved.
Second.
Those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
There being no old business, we'll move on to new business. I'm seeking approval for resolution 15-14. It is recommended that the Board of Commissioners adopt 1514, approving supplemental work plan number 7 and environmental evaluation, and approving and authorizing the signing of supplemental work plan agreement number 7 for Hibernia Dam.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Public comment on any agenda item at this time. We will have a second public comment portion at the end of the meeting. We'll move on to resolution 1614, which seeks the same type of authorization set forth in the previous resolution, but for work plan number 8 for Beaver Creek Dam. Looking for
a motion to approve resolution 1614. I make that motion.
Second.
Motion and second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Resolution 1714 seeks to adopt authorization of financing by Central and Western Chester County IDA of certain projects for YMCA of Upper Main Line. I'll make said resolution.
Second.
I'll make motion to approve said resolution. Motion and second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And resolution 1814 is to authorize a financing, refunding, by the Euclid Township IDA of a project for YMCA of Upper Main Line.
Motion to approve.
I'll second. Those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Resolution 1914, it's recommended the board adopt the resolution which is embedded in the Emergency Solutions Grant for the Department of Community and Economic Development. I'll make that motion.
Second.
Motion second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Very good. We'll move to the contracts, and I would ask Mr. Farrell to lead us.
The 16 contracts were sunshine yesterday. They are contracts for children, youth, and families, community development, facilities management, managed behavior health care, and cops and home. I'd motion to approve the contracts agenda.
And I'll second. Those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Ms. Cazone, the grants.
All of these grants were sunshined yesterday in the Departments of Community Development, Juvenile Probation, and Public Health. I make a motion to approve.
And I'll second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The HR agenda was discussed in executive session yesterday. It consists of 37 items, retirements, end of employments, promotions, hires and rehires and transfers. I'll motion to approve the HR agenda.
Second.
Motion second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The finance agenda was expertly sunshined by our own Mark Rupsis yesterday. Renewal of Pocopson's professional and general liability coverages, saving us, I believe, around $15,000 over last year. Budget change 24 of 2013, budget change 4 of 2014, and vouchers as submitted by the controller. I'll motion to approve the finance agenda.
Second.
Motion second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We will, public comment from anyone? Yes, sir. And then we will follow public comment with our pipeline safety update.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, my name is Casey Jones. I reside in Parkersburg Borough. And I'd like to commend the board for its action last week in recognizing the tireless efforts of many county workers and volunteers who were involved in providing services during the last storm that hit the county earlier this month, with many of them, I expect, also encountering a lot of personal sacrifice on their own in serving the public. But at the same time, I feel the need to separate out the rhetoric from facts as it relates to the continued lack, a huge gap, as it relates to any real information plan that guides the public in making decisions of importance to them in disaster situations like that which occurred during the recent ice storm. At the Pennsylvania Emergency Management Agency training just this past week, as with many others that have occurred over the last two or three years in this area, it was emphasized that effective public information in times of a disaster first has a goal: to get the right information to the right people at the right time to make the right decision. Second, supports the mission of emergency management. Third, reaches a broader audience. And then in addition, a real solid piece of the emergency management coordinator's role is to ensure that public gets that information to help guide the public and also to keep the information synchronized. As you'll recall, this is the not the first, the second, but the third time in more than a year that I've been here before you to say that the county has a public information communication problem and that this board is in charge of that problem. There also has been more than once, twice, three, four times now that I have communicated this problem to the county over a 2.5 year period to various county officials. Unfortunately, virtually everything I've said, after not once, but twice, but three hurricanes, one tropical storm, and now an ice storm and a major snowstorm, have come true. And I myself personally have experienced them. Last week, the board accurately stated that, quote, information is also vital during storm emergencies, and Chester County citizens also need accurate information. Last week, the director confirmed that getting the word out in all ways and in any way it can is of importance. But this is not happening. I would strongly suggest that it is highly misleading when this board said that the Emergency Operating Center maintained a regular stream of information to the county residents through the media and social media. Last week, the director reported some 250 social media disseminations during the storm. What was not said, however, was that more than two-thirds of these, as best as I can tell anyway, were harmful repeats. And I say harmful because I and 90% of the other people in the county were without power at any one point, and many for as long as 5 or 6 days. The primary information device I have had that I hold is a handheld smartphone, which many people in this county do not have. The constant repeating of information helped wear down my battery while trying to absorb all those repeats, caused further battery strain by having to click over to other sites to see information if it actually had changed or not, and caused me to miss at least two messages that were different but buried among the repeats. In addition, due to a lack of critical information...
I'm confused. You're saying that your phone battery was draining because you were on social media and the news feed, which you continue to look at with information that you found to be redundant, was causing your phone battery to drain? Is that what you just
Certainly,
said?
Certainly, anytime that you have your phone on, your battery is draining.
But if you're on social media, the news feeds are, as we all know, unending. They just keep coming.
That's correct.
So whether it was that or whether it was your neighbor talking about how their electricity's out or any number of different things, if that wasn't there, wouldn't something else have shown up in your news feed at that very same moment?
Not in mine.
Okay.
I only pick and choose my news feeds for those that I feel that are important. And so as a result, when I go down through the news feeds, okay, I don't use the news feeds most of the time. I actually use the county site. And so as a result, I'm going down through the county site, get to the end, I have to click over. If there's something that has a hashtag on it, I have to click over to that. And so all of those things being repetitive over and over and over again of information, sometimes as many as 3 or 4 or 5, 6 times, I have to go through those, and it takes time to absorb those and find out what is exactly new and what isn't exactly new.
All right. Well, it's your public. I just wanted to make sure I understood that correctly.
In addition, due to a lack of critical information from the county, continued searches had to be made at other sites trying to find needed information, further draining battery power, particularly for those in poor cell phone reception areas. I personally was fortunate to have received the Christmas gift of a pocket battery charger, and it had a small amount of computer backup power that was able to be used very sparingly, personally. Many Chester County residents did not have that. If my own power outage has stretched beyond the 2 days plus that it did, this battery power also would have been stretched and probably it would have been eliminated. County emergency management did do a better job of advance notification of the storm, something that I did cite before when I was here is a major problem in two prior appearances. However, despite county social media broadcasting at least a dozen times for county residents to sign up for Ready Notify PA learning system, Chester County Ready Notify PA basically dropped off the cliff as a storm landed in the county. At 6:55 p.m. Tuesday, the night before the storm, a weather watch and advisory was issued via Ready Notify PA. After that, for the next 2.5 days, there were six county-originated general messages. One was for establishment of 5 warming stations without any explanation as to what the warming station is or what it is that you're supposed to do with it or how you're supposed to use it. One, that the Avon Grove warming station was moved, and 4 notices, 2/3 of the total, being in regard to county offices being closed or delayed in opening. There was also a handful of local specific statements on Ready Notify PA. Then, 2.5 days later, a message was sent, apparently to all individuals signed up for local government messages that said, PECO advises that they're getting Chester County roadways open, but residents may see wires lying alongside the side of the road, but do not go near those wires. And then silence again for the rest of the storm. 7 messages, with 4 of them county office closings, was a widely promoted county emergency public information system in action. There was no public information disseminated by the county in regard to power outages and where they were. The 350-some roads, according to the director...
Hold on a second. The power outages, there was a link to the PECO site, and you could click on the PECO site as to the cumulative power outage totals by municipality. And it would be PECO that would be the expert and the authoritative, expert's the wrong word, authoritative source as to where power was out.
And it was where, sir?
You can go, PECO had it on their, on maps.
Well, I found it after I looked for it.
But isn't the point that the information is available to a reasonably intelligent information seeker on the web, or anyone? Obviously, television was out, but I mean, is it your assertion that the county should be a clearinghouse for all storm damage related information?
That's correct.
Even in areas where we don't have jurisdiction, such as electrical outages,
to the extent that. Number one is that if I'm in an emergency situation, and this situation involving the ice storm, I would suggest is only a tip of the iceberg of what could occur, such as if we had a Sandy. And I mentioned before that if Sandy had come ashore at a different location, which had been projected, that this county would have been the New Jersey of this, would be the New Jersey a couple of years ago, is that if I'm in an emergency situation, I as a consumer or as a resident need to be able to go to one source that is authoritative, that has accurate information, that has good information, and so that I can, from that, I can click over to those things of which I'm interested in. But for me, as a consumer, in an emergency situation in which I'm trying to protect myself, my family, and my
yes, but at the same point in time, the County Department of Emergency Services cannot be considered the authoritative source for weather predictions, for power outages, for a number of different things. For even, I mean, we can say SEPTA service has been discontinued for the time being, but it's SEPTA that makes that determination. So we can pass some information on, but when you say authoritative, the question becomes authoritative over what subject matter? And it cannot be over comprehensively all subject matter. Do you understand what my point is there?
I understand your point. I think that and I've been here three times now, is that you're missing my point. And that is that as a consumer, as a resident who's trying to protect myself, family, and property, that I need a reliable source to go to. And all of the trainings that FEMA provides, all of the trainings that PEMA provides on this subject say the same thing. And I've taken many of those trainings. Basically is that we need an accurate and reliable source. And when I say accurate, it's in the aspect of the same thing that I do in regard to the newsletters that I publish, is that I state a situation, like with a weather report, and I say, here is where I can go for additional information.
Right.
If I, as a consumer or as a resident, want to go there, that becomes my issue then. It's not that. But without that central located situation and point, and I'll get to that in a second, is that other people are doing that, and they're doing it effectively. They're not spending a lot of money, a lot of resources, and things like this, and they're getting the information that needs to be generated in order to make it work.
It is, and this is, you have conveyed this several times. Two things. Number one, I haven't heard anything that suggests that the information that has been provided by our emergency services has been anything but accurate and reliable. If you have an instance where something was factually inaccurate, it should be something that should be brought to our attention. That's the first point. The second point is I believe that our director, who's not here, and I don't want to put words into his mouth, believes that some of your statements are opining on what you think should be included in addition to what is provided. And they also have a significant background and ongoing interactions with PEMA and FEMA throughout these storms, or any natural disaster type occurrence. So some of what you're saying, I believe you're presenting in a very conclusive fashion, when I believe it's more your opinion on how you'd like to see it done versus the fact that it is being done in an accurate and reliable way. We're just maybe not having our emergency services just aren't saying everything that you'd like them to say, or they're referring to other more authoritative sources such as PICO or such as transportation systems or such as the National Weather Service, when you think that somehow we should be providing that information as a originating source of that.
That's not correct. I'm not saying you should be the originating source. I'm saying that you should provide information and to provide the information as to where people can get the information if that's specifically what they're interested in. That's number one.
Can I respond to that for one second, though? Let's just go back to PICO, because I will tell you there were numerous notifications that came out from the Department of Emergency Services that explained to people exactly where they could go on the web or by telephone to get service from PICO. In addition, I know that all three commissioners, not to mention a number of the staff and other people in the county, were reposting and retweeting that information all throughout social media. I also know that it was in the newspapers, it was on the radio, and further, there was additional information when 211 was set up to address people's other kinds of needs, that was disseminated in a way that at least I thought was probably wider in this instance than in some instances in the past. So it's unclear to me exactly what it is that the county wasn't putting out there in ways for people to be able to go to certain places to get the information they needed, including PICO and including social services.
Building off what she just said, furthermore, we were a clearinghouse and an organizational mechanism through which we could get information at the local level and organize it. There was additional communications outreach from a lot of the municipal emergency management coordinators, law enforcement, first responders, fire companies, and they, being the boots on the ground, had additional communications themselves at a much more granular level with their local constituents. So I think, and we'll let you continue with your public comments at this point.
Well, the basic issue still ends up being is that you're characterizing this as my opinion. Okay, I'm taking this opinion from FEMA. I'm taking it from other trainings that they provide and others provide in regard to that, which basically is universal and is consistent in regard to how it should work. I've also taken it from places in which it does work and does work effectively. This is not how it's occurring in Chester County, and I'll get to that in a second if
okay.
you let me tie through that.
Very good.
Okay. In the meantime, let's look at where it was working. Well, let me think. In fact, remember the notices we received in regard to the warming station? There was no subsequent ready notify alert in regard to opening a shelter at Westchester University. Zero. Zip. The first word I actually received about the shelter was a news release via email from the Pennsylvania Commonwealth Marketing Director in Harrisburg. The general public would not have received this message. In the meantime, let's look elsewhere as to where it was working. If someone was fortunate enough to be in West Pikeland Township or signed up for their specific service for some reason, they received 9 Ready Notify PA messages along with 4 emails that provided ongoing status reports of power outages and road closures. If someone was fortunate enough to be on State Representative Camp's district, they received 9 email reports to his constituents. Some other state legislators also provide at least small pieces of information to their constituents. In neighboring Montgomery County, there
presumably
were
those updates from those more local officials were for those local areas, right?
That's correct.
And furthermore, presumably the people that follow those pages are people that live in that specific locality.
That's correct.
And so what you're suggesting is we should have all of that in our news feed so that people in Parksburg are observing what specifically is going on in Tredyffrin on a more increased
correct.
Basis.
That's not correct.
Okay, I'm
what
sorry. I'm trying to understand
that,
what you're saying.
What I'm trying to say is that for county issues, the county needs to be doing the same thing as even the local mini municipalities are doing in order to affect the county. And the reason I say that is this also, is that people who live in Chester County, a lot of people who live in Chester County are mobile. So it's not what affects me in Parksburg. It's where I am traveling that day. It's where I'm working that day. It's where other things that are occurring that day. So we have a more universal aspect of what we need to know. The county wasn't providing anything along with status reports, again, road closures, PICO situations and so forth. Now, I'm not sure where you are saying that Ready Notify PA published that information, because in fact, I went through the logs, yesterday, and there was nothing there. I just gave you the logs. Well, 7 messages, 4 of them in regard to county office building closings, which apparently are more important than the life and property of people in the county. It makes no sense.
I think that we would disagree with some of your factual assertions as well as some of the conclusions that you've leapt to, but it is public comment and you're entitled to your opinion.
Mm-hmm. And if you will actually go to those sites, I can show you the logs and so on and so forth. I can document everything that I'm talking about, everything. In addition to that, in neighboring Montgomery County, there were 10 status reports at least, plus additional information, a lot of additional information for both the county and also the chairman of the Montgomery County Commissioners, who also conferred with the governor and Pima director on Thursday, the day after the disaster. This lack of information has extended to the warming stations and shelters. In order to access the shelter at Westchester, one must drive an hour to an hour and a half from round trip from western and northwestern parts of the county. That's in good driving conditions. In this past storm, one had no ideas to road closures because, again, they were not publicized, or the prospect of suddenly finding themselves in the midst of hampering cleanup operations by driving. Chester County is 750 square miles in size and had 5 advertised warming stations. Montgomery County is only 483 square miles, or a third less in size. They had 24. Due to no real idea as to what was available at warming stations, I personally went to Cochranville Fire Department on Thursday afternoon simply to check out what actually transpires there, what's available, and who I might be able to refer people, where I might be able to refer people if I came across them that might need that service. And found it also had an overnight accommodations 5 miles from my house versus 35 minutes minimum one way to Westchester. There only were 4 people there, presumably because if someone had a need, they were being directed to Westchester, 35 minutes or more away. People, even in a disaster situation, have a fear of shelters, being separated from home and what is going on there, and also unknown road conditions. Again, when you don't know if there's clear sailing between here and there, you don't want to be caught out in the middle of someplace without any protection along that line. The next day, I checked out the Catholic school in West Brandywine Township and found that it too had overnight accommodations, yet people were being directed to Westchester. I also experienced very bad responses that related to the much heralded 211 system and the supposed connection between PICO, Verizon, and Comcast, and that would take too long to go through at this point in time, but I'd certainly be happy to share that information if it's desired. In summary, it's very apparent, as I've reported for the past 2.5 years, that the public information system, or lack thereof, in Chester County in regard to disasters is not up to snuff, very much not up to snuff. I again am requesting that the board assume its required lawful leadership role in this issue to help ensure that this huge gap and void be resolved quickly. No one can predict when another disaster will occur. In fact, the last time I was before this board in South Coatesville, I went home and a storm watch was turned into a hurricane. Frankly, I simply can't comprehend why this issue hasn't been taken care of after 2.5 years, 3 hurricanes, 1 tropical storm, an ice storm now, and a major snowstorm. It is not rocket science. As the ice storm was winding down and the major snowstorm was appearing on the horizon, I decided to test this issue myself. A social media site was developed in simply hours without my having used such media previously. I believe it demonstrated much of the hard content that is needed in these types of situations in the referral process to get people real information. Without my even having access to all the information that is available through millions of dollars that the county has and is able to access in situations such as this. Chester County staff and volunteers did a lot of great things for residents during this recent storm. Why can't we fix this huge gap that affects every one of its 500,000 people and do the best possible job possible? Please let me know when this issue is going to be addressed and also resolved. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We will move on now to any other public comment. Does not appear. Mr. Farrell.
I just note the attendance of our controller, Norm McQueen. Thank you for your attendance.
And we now look forward to the pipeline safety update from our pipeline safety gurus. That's right.
Good morning, commissioners. My name is Ronald Bailey, and I'm the executive director of the Chester County Planning Commission. And this morning, we want to brief you a little bit on progress that we are making with an initiative that developed last year through the good offices of the Pipeline Safety Coalition. Bear with me just a minute here. In that process, we are trying to establish a new initiative in response to commissioners' concerns. And I apologize, there's not going to be a screen behind the commissioners this morning, which we're going to see, so we're going to have to look at things that are showing up there, which aren't showing up on my screen. So interesting. Hang on just a minute here.
It's on the monitors out
there. Anyway, while I am doing this, I would like to introduce to the commissioners Linda Farrell, who is the director of the Pipeline Safety Coalition and who is the principal author of an initiative that was funded by a grant from the Federal Department of Transportation Pipeline Safety and Hazardous Materials Agency. And Linda, if you want to kind of give your background, and in the meantime, I'll try and bring this technology up here.
We can share. Thank you. Thank you, Ronald. Hello, my name is Linda Farrell. I'm the executive director of Pipeline Safety Coalition. We are a Pennsylvania nonprofit dedicated to building partnerships with residents, safety advocates, government and industry in order to improve public safety, personal and environmental safety and pipeline issues through collaborative educational efforts. We believe that safety can be defined as the control of recognized hazards to achieve an acceptable level of risk in the protection of people, possessions, and the environment. We came to the PHMSA TAG grants as a result of our interest in those goals of our mission statement. And I do have to say that that we thank the commissioners, the Planning Commission, and Scott Pearsall, who is the East Brandywine Township Manager, for their participation in making this this concept a reality. Frankly, without the vision and the commitment of the commissioners, this would have remained, the concept of a notification protocol would have remained simply that, a good idea. Without Scott Pearsall, who diligently collaborated with us, the trials and tribulations of procurement of an administration of a grant would not have occurred. And without the talents and the expertise and the dedication of the Planning Commission, the work product, which we are calling the Pipeline Notification Protocol with PHMSA, and which the county is building a PIC website, which Ronald will explain to y'all. Without the Planning Commission's expertise, the project wouldn't have taken on the exemplary form and that it has taken on, and we wouldn't have been able to engage 49% of the operators here in Chester County. 49% of operator participation is indeed extraordinary. And I know that Ronald will talk to you about the notification protocol in more depth, but essentially it came about because the commissioners realized that, and Pipeline Safety Coalition had a conversation with the commissioners regarding the fact that there is not currently a defined protocol or a system for operators to contact the county when they're planning a pipeline project, whether it be expanding an existing pipeline or putting in a new pipeline or repairing a pipeline. And this is an issue that USDOT PHMSA, the Pipeline and Hazardous Materials Safety Administration, had dealt with in a 2010 publication, PIPA. Well, what we did was we looked at the PIPA document and said, how can we adapt that? How can we adopt that to Chester County needs? And so again, Ronald will tell you more about the protocol itself, but I'd like to tell you about some of the far-reaching effects that the PIPA work has achieved. And again, without the commissioners and the Planning Commission, Pipeline Safety Coalition would not have been able to achieve this collaborative effort that's really snowballing. In the year 2013-14, Pipeline Safety Coalition has been awarded another technical assistance grant through PHMSA to take the Chester County Pipeline Notification Protocol to the other 66 counties of Pennsylvania. We're receiving very enthusiastic response for the introduction and the adaption and adoption to specific areas of the Commonwealth. And we're doing that in collaboration with the commissioners and collaboration with the Planning Commission to provide a seamless sharing of the efficient and time-sensitive continuance of the Pipeline Notification Protocol. So I thank the commissioners and the Planning Commission for that continuing collaboration. Pipeline Safety Coalition, through vetting the Pipeline Notification Protocol, as you may remember, held a June 2013 meeting with Columbia Pipeline and with the FERC, with the Pipeline Notification Protocol community, and we received actually a beyond room capacity outreach from the community. That meeting was geared to initially gauge how Pipeline Notification Protocol could help to impact the or influence the continued improved communications with the community when it comes to the regulatory process and where the community can participate proactively to ensure a safer community here in Chester County. As a result of the community input of that meeting, Columbia did change some of the proposed route. And we saw that collectively, we saw that as an improvement. And when I say collectively, I talk about Columbia Pipeline, NiSource, as well as the stakeholders of the county and community. So as a result of that, we're in conversation too with Sunoco, who is in process of the Mariner East projects in Chester County and throughout the Commonwealth. Sunoco has seen the benefits, the proactive benefits of the pipeline notification protocol, and Mr. Bailey and Sunoco and I will be meeting in March. We'll be also discussing a follow-up community meeting that will be very much geared to the format that we used in the Columbia Pipeline project. We also PNP has also enabled Pipeline Safety Coalition to expand on a community active advocacy program that we have been vetting for about a year. And this started with the Warwick Township, East Dantmuir Township community groups forming over the proposed Commonwealth Pipeline. What we found was we had three NGOs, Pipeline Safety Coalition, Berks Gas Truth, and Delaware Riverkeeper Network, that worked with East Dantmuir and Warwick Townships to form community groups. Now, in the process of the last year, and for just for transparency here, in great part, the fact that the Commonwealth Pipeline is now on indefinite hold had a great deal to do with the community participation, the county participation, the local municipality participation prior to the FERC siting process, and enabled the community to point to the FERC, again, prior to the siting process, the environmental impacts to the Hopewell Big Woods and to the EV streams, the exceptional value streams in that area. They've been protected now, at least temporarily, due to the proactive and educated community participation that occurred with those groups. Those groups also were looking to the PNP. In January, shortly after these groups started to form, the PNP was initially introduced at a couple of meetings, and the community has been following the PNP. They've been anxiously awaiting the report that was provided in December, and which is publicly available. And they see the connection between the PNP and what we are forming. We call it CAN, C-A-N, Community Activacy Network. We think that enables us to work beyond simply the pipeline issues that face us here in Chester County. And so those community groups will be forming mentoring groups so that they will be paying it forward, so to speak. East Warwick and Natmill Township community groups and the municipal officials are working with Pipeline Safety Coalition. We will be working with the PNP project to enhance the community communications within the community. We're also working with realtors. We met with realtors last week. The connection to the real estate community was always something that we wanted to address in PNP over time, and the realtors are seeing that this is a benefit to their clients. Their clients appreciate the fact that the realtors are stepping up to the plate and saying, by the way, did you know there is an easement, rather than waiting for the client to notice that there's an easement. So that's a very strong connection that we'll be making with the PNP as well. So again, I thank the commissioners and the Planning Commission. Do you have any questions prior to Ronald taking over? Thank you.
As most of us from time to time go to a motion picture theater, and before the program starts, we all get to see trailers of coming features. And what I'm going to show you this morning essentially is a trailer of a coming feature. Instead of a trailer showing you what movie will be released this June, I'm going to show you something about what we're going to be releasing on our website, hopefully by the end of March. And we call this the Pipeline Information Center. It should be on the commissioner's monitors as well as these monitors up here. And these
it is on our monitors, so when we're looking here and not at you, don't think we're not paying attention.
That's good. Yeah, do stare the monitor. What we are setting up is what we're calling the Pipeline Information Center. It's going to be a web-based application that we're designing to be a help for residents of the county, property owners of the county, municipal officials in the county, as well as the pipeline companies. It's intended to be a neutral source of information that will facilitate a lot of things. And this is the architecture of the website. And real quickly, everything that you see in green is going to be up online by the end of March. And what you see in blue are things that we hope to be able to add to the information center at a future date as resources become available. But it will be called the, as I said, the Pipeline Information Center, and it will have lots of information that people can ask questions and can go to different sites. For instance, basic information of why this website is created. As Linda was talking, I'm sure she was using a lot of terms that she and I are familiar with, but maybe the rest of you never heard of. For instance, PHMSA and FERC and all kinds of things of this nature. This website will introduce all that information to the public, to property owners. It will help explain how these different agencies and entities relate to the development, location, and safety of pipelines in the county. And it will also be optimized for both a desktop version and a mobile version, and it will include lots of graphics, lots of different maps that will show things that affect pipelines. For instance, one of the maps that we're developing right here is an interactive map that will show all the pipelines in the county. It will be scalable down to the neighborhood area, so you'll basically be able to see the houses in your neighborhood. And it will show where we best information we have on the location of the pipeline and 1,000 feet on either side of that pipeline, which we're identifying as consultation zones. Linda mentioned the PIPA protocol, and that's what we're relating to here. And so if you're a property owner and you see that one of these pipeline consultation zones is ranging through your neighborhood, you click on that, you'll see a little box come up, as you see right here on the right-hand side, that will identify for you what the pipeline is, who owns the pipeline, and it will contain additional information and links. So for instance, if you scroll down and were to click on that box, then it would link you with other information, such as the web pages of the pipeline companies, so that you can get more detailed information about what's going on, what's going to affect your property, things of that nature. We will also identify all the pipelines for planning purposes and important things that are in relation to those pipelines, such as where are the fire stations located if there is a safety issue? How do we respond to these? Which pipelines are in proximity to public schools? What kind of issues and hazards does that raise? One of the things that we are very sensitive to is that some of these pipelines were built many years ago, and there are two standards for pipelines. There is a standard for an urban pipeline and a standard for a rural pipeline. The standards for an urban pipeline are a higher safety level. The pipelines have to be buried deeper. They have to have safety valves more frequently, different construction materials. Unfortunately, when some of the pipelines were built in Chester County, it was before the great stages of urbanization that we've sustained in the last couple of decades. And so some of these pipelines are still of a rural standard. So for planning purposes, we want to identify those and engage with the pipeline operators in order to improve and update the safety of those pipelines. The other thing that was mentioned is that these pipelines run across private property. Private property that is owned by residents, by businesses of this county, many of whom, unfortunately, are not aware until somebody comes knocking on their door that they have an easement for a pipeline or what the conditions of that easement are. So one of the things that we're going to have in this information center for residents is information about easements, how people can find information on those easements, and what the easements means. What does the language in those types of easements means? So for instance, we will link with the Recorder of Deeds office where all the deeds that have easements on them are recorded, and we will include information on how to research this information and find information that is of particular importance. One of the other things that is a common misconception is people think that pipelines must be regulated. A lot of people initially think, well, it has to be the county that's doing the regulation. In fact, we have very little authority as a governmental entity to regulate pipelines. There are two federal agencies. One is called the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, or FERC. But it only regulates the location and siting of power lines or pipelines that are of interstate nature. For instance, if it's a pipeline that's beginning in Texas and coming through Chester County, FERC is involved with it. If it is a pipeline that begins in Pennsylvania and ends in Pennsylvania, such as a pipeline coming from the Marcellus shale fields, there is no agency, federal or state, that regulates the location of those pipelines. Pennsylvania is one of two states in the nation that does not regulate intrastate pipelines. So we want to make that information also available to people so that they understand what the system is and what those agencies are, how they can contact those agencies. Now, that is talking about the location of pipelines. The safety of the pipelines is regulated. It is regulated by a agency of the Federal Department of Transportation, and it is regulated under contract with that agency by the Pennsylvania Public Utilities Commission. So again, we will make this information available to people as they might need to use it. And we'll have all kinds of information in there explaining what these agencies do, what their authority is, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And something else that we will include in this will be some information on a very recent Supreme Court decision that affected a act of the General Assembly of Pennsylvania, Act 13 of 2 years ago, that dealt with pipelines from the Marcellus Shale region. And the Supreme Court has overturned portions of that, particularly with respect to zoning. And that's all fine because we don't have any Marcellus shale lands in Chester County. But what's really significant about this decision is that the court, the Supreme Court, basically ruled that the powers of local government, including counties, are derived from the Pennsylvania Constitution and from acts of the General Assembly. We have always understood that the Pennsylvania Constitution speaks to a few jurisdictions specifically. The city of county of Philadelphia, Allegheny County, and therefore those jurisdictions have powers that derive directly from the Constitution. But for all other jurisdictions, like a third-class county such as Chester County, we have always assumed that we have to have express authorization and express enabling legislation from the General Assembly. The Pennsylvania Supreme Court may somewhat have turned this on its head by saying no, that there are provisions in the Pennsylvania Constitution that directly
Who wants to reflect what I believe to be the unanimous feelings of the board on this?
I think we could probably all find ways to say the same thing differently, but I wanted to, I'm sure we'll all agree, I wanted to thank Ronald and the folks at the planning department who've worked really, really hard to bring this to its fruition. Linda and the Pipeline Safety Coalition for partnering with us and Scott to make the grant happen in the first place. I think that we have now seen that we're able to provide some really valuable information to our citizens. And I think there's a lot of discussion happening around the county about pipelines. There are only certain things that we can do in the county. And it was abundantly clear that one of the biggest issues was about communication. And I think that this will provide an opportunity for the citizens and municipalities to have, you know, that one place where they can go to get some information. I know that you'll all be working diligently on trying to secure some additional resources to think about ways we can implement, we'll call it phase two of this project, because I think keeping us moving and up to date on this project and all things pipeline that are happening in Chester County is going to be critical as we move forward, and I have every faith in you and your organization that we'll be able to get there. So really, really great job. I think the community will be very pleased with the information that they'll have at their fingertips pretty quickly come the end of March. So thank you both. And Ronald, I hope you'll share that with your staff, that we're grateful for all the time and effort that has gone into this so far. Good job.
Yeah, on the serious level, I echo my colleagues' comments, but being flippant a little bit, I'd like to know whether this will be available on demand, and I could share this with my wife and my neighbors. Netflix. Netflix. Okay, I will download this. I will download this, and right after.
We'll set a feature on it.
Okay. Thank you. No, seriously, thank you for all the work.
I agree with everything that was said. I was also struck by how it appeared to be very easily navigable. It was a nice, intuitive, clear layout from what I could see on the screen. So we're looking forward to it going live and letting our constituents see the good work that you did. It's not something that we had to do. It's something that we felt reflects the values that we hold on this board as being transparent, helpful, going the extra mile, and I think it'll serve a lot of people's interests moving forward. So thank you for a job well done, and we look forward to continuing in furtherance of the effort.
I think it's also noteworthy of emphasis that used as a model throughout the state. And once again, Chester County takes a lead position and things as Commissioner Costello said, that we didn't need to do and that we're doing well are translating into some protocols that will be useful to citizens throughout Pennsylvania.
Is there any other questions at this point or any other comments? If there are not, we will revisit public comment. Does anyone else have any public comment? Not appearing there to be any, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Drive safe, everyone.